This audio recording was produced in 2014 by Mission Audio, which owns the copyright. No portion of this recording may be reproduced for any reason without prior written consent from Mission Audio. This edition recorded by arrangement with Multnomah Books, an imprint of Crown Publishing Group, a division of Random House, LLC. Please visit booksandaudio.com to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles.
Multnomah Drive Audio presents America's Real War by Rabbi Daniel Lapin. Chapter 1. Why would a rabbi ally with religious Christians? A captured prisoner of war is required to declare only his name, rank, service number, and date of birth. This is because all the really profound information about him is already revealed by his uniform. That distinctive garment eloquently proclaims the side for which the warrior is fighting. Although not a prisoner of war, I am among those engaged in a fierce American conflict. It may be the fiercest internal conflict in American history since the abolitionist movement in the 1800s. It is certainly deeply consequential. And I am in the heart of it. This book is my uniform. In addition to the information contained in my uniform, the U.S. Military Code of Conduct grants you the right to the equivalent of my name, rank, service number, and date of birth. Here is the vital data. I am an Orthodox rabbi. I am the son of a famous Orthodox rabbi and the brother of two more. My teachers were the great scholars who headed the Gateshead Talmudic Academy in England, some of whom were uncles and cousins. I became a disciple of my great-uncle, the revered Rabbi Eliyahu Elijah Lopian, the original family name, during my many years of study at the Theological Academy, or Yeshiva, of Kfar Hasidim in Israel. Although I am sure I often fall short, I do my best to live my life and raise my children according to the laws of the five books of Moses, our holy Torah, and the customs of Moses and of Israel. Because it is unusual these days for Jews to say nice things about Christians, I consider it necessary to explain that I am not now, nor have I ever been, a Christian. Being infatuated with Judaism and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I dedicate my study time to expanding my familiarity with Jewish theology. In the midst of a lifelong love affair with the searing truth of the Torah, I reject any notion of theological compatibility between Judaism and Christianity. I do not believe a Jew can also be a Christian without betraying his Judaism. One faith, Judaism, has produced the longest-lasting continuous culture in the history of the world, while the other, Christianity, has been responsible, among other things, for the founding of America, the greatest civilization the world has ever known. This book will describe how a weakened Christianity in America threatens all Americans, including Jews. My defense of Christianity in America these past years has earned me considerable hostility from many Americans. This book will describe why so many secularized Americans and so many Jews wrongly fear Christianity in America today. I find myself driven to make the case for Christianity in America by three compelling reasons. The first is because I desperately want my children, and one day, God willing, my grandchildren and their descendants, to have the option of living peacefully and productively in the United States of America. I am certain this depends upon America regaining its Christian-oriented moral compass. The second reason is that I am appalled by the great injustice being perpetrated by those Jewish organizations that engage in anti-Christian bigotry. Although many of them were founded explicitly to fight bigotry, and for many years did just that, today the shrill rhetoric and hate-filled propaganda found in their direct mail is discriminatory and divisive. The very same Jewish organizations would be the loudest protesters were anything even remotely similar being said by non-Jews about Jews. Justice demands that a member of the group doing the defaming also does the defending. Third, I wish to counter the Chilul Hashem, the desecration of God's name that is caused when His words are misrepresented. Organizations and individuals, many of whom claim to speak in the name of Judaism, are inflicting enormous harm on America by promoting policies that traditional Judaism finds abhorrent. I want to help both Jewish and non-Jewish Americans differentiate between Jewish positions and positions held by some Jews who are more devoted to secularism than to Judaism. I feel that all Americans who love freedom, whether or not they are religious, should welcome the reawakening of earnest Christianity throughout the land. I shall try to establish that Jews, as well as other minorities, have the most to fear from a post-Christian America. I believe America is in decline. Most Americans who can remember back 35 years or so sense that life has become more squalid, expensive, and dangerous. Some attribute this to inadequate government attention to social problems, while others lay the blame at the feet of a more fundamental spiritual malaise. One thing is clear, however. Fewer and fewer Americans remain unaware of or indifferent to America's decline. Whether it is in the hollow expressions on the faces of some youngsters, the vulgarity of entertainment, or the many other little signs that all is not well in America, most of us are at least concerned about the future. There is a tug of war going on for the future of our country. Many Americans feel uncommitted to the entire agenda of either side, but feel the need to make their voices heard one way or the other. What do the two ends of the rope represent? I believe the basic question is whether America is a secular or a religious nation. One end of the rope is anchored by those who ask, how can any intelligent, rational person late in the 20th century view America as a religious nation? While lacking a doctrinal embrace of secularism, these Americans have come to feel that religious America poses the real threat to our continuity, so they instinctively migrate to the end of the rope opposite from religious conservatives. Across the field, at the other end of the rope, are those Americans who feel increasingly alienated by this enlightened perspective, which denies the importance of America's history and culture. These religious conservatives are joined by many other Americans who, while admittedly unenthusiastic about religion, are even less enthusiastic about the changes that secular liberalism has brought about in their towns and communities. In the pages following, I will argue that America is a religious nation, and the corresponding interpretation of our history and culture is the correct one. But I shall go much further than that. America is not just religious, but is rooted in one particular religious tradition. As an Orthodox rabbi, I will make a compelling case for America as a Christian nation that needs to be based on Judeo-Christian ethics in order to survive. Despite the fact that Judaism and Christianity have totally differing theologies, there is still one Judeo-Christian ethic. Which is to say that how people order their lives and societies, how they organize their families and behave toward one another, turns out to be more similar than different. The origins, legal system, ethos, and moral sense of America are entirely Judeo-Christian. A Jew and a Christian at one end of the rope have more in common with one another in terms of a vision for this country than each has with his co-religionists at the rope's opposite end. This is because the tug of war is not about theological or philosophical differences, but about real life disagreements, about things like taxes, crime, welfare, and family life. No matter the philosophy of belief that brings us to our view of how things ought to be, we tend to agree with others holding the same view, regardless of whatever belief brought them to that view. This begs another question asked by well-intentioned but worried Americans. Many of those pulling for the secular side of the tug of war may concede that there is at least some truth to the Judeo-Christian religious foundation of America. But at the same time, they argue that nowadays a new secular public policy posture has become necessary because of America's increasing diversity. Otherwise, they argue, America will become intolerant of its minorities who may not share in our founding ethic. The question for those who take this position is not, is America a Christian nation? But should America be a Christian nation? As a non-Christian myself, I still insist the answer must be yes. I shall try to demonstrate that the choice is between a benign Christian culture and a sinister secular one. Are you Jewish, Christian, or neither? Are you indifferent to religion, fervently for, or ardently opposed to faith? It matters little. As long as you devoutly wish for America to remain a beacon of hope and freedom in this troubled world, I appeal to you. What we really think about God deep down within our hearts is likely to influence what we think about almost everything else. I intend to show you how changing attitudes about God have almost entirely reshaped America during the past 3 or 4 decades. Those readers who applaud the changes will smile knowingly as I identify the milestones on our road downhill. Those who tremble at what we have come to accept as normal will see my words as a roadmap for retracing our steps and regaining the right path to continue the great story that is American history. America is indeed imperiled. We all know that. However, we disagree with one another about the source of the danger. Some of us think religious fervor threatens, while others fear secularism. Chapter 2: Striking the Iceberg. The sinking of the Titanic makes a perfect metaphor for the unexpected demise of a great and apparently invulnerable enterprise. Could the unprecedented popularity of the movie of the same name be caused by a widespread subconscious awareness that the movie is a metaphor? Although this seems fanciful, it would not be the first time a movie resonated with the public because of a subtle message from the underlying motif. One thinks of the ship of state sailing serenely through time when suddenly she strikes an iceberg. Is that what has happened to our land? In the much-seen James Cameron movie, more than half the film elapsed before the Titanic reached the iceberg. In Walter Lord's 1955 book, A Night to Remember, the majestic liner hit the fatal berg on page 3. Walter Lord correctly saw that the real story was to be found in the time between the impact with the iceberg and the sinking of the mighty ship. What exact moment condemned the Titanic? Was it the design of the lifeboat systems? Was it the choice of material used in the hull? Was it actually the moment the great ship struck the iceberg? It's often difficult to pinpoint a precise moment of doom. What moment sealed the fate of millions of people by making World War II inevitable? Was it when Hitler invaded the Rhineland on a cold Saturday morning in March 1936? Was it perhaps in 1919 when a treaty was signed at Versailles prohibiting Germany from entering that 30-mile-wide stretch of land on both banks of the River Rhine? Or could all the carnage of World War II have had its start with the murder of Austrian Archduke Francis Ferdinand at Sarajevo on June 28, 1914, which many historians feel launched World War I and made almost all else during the next 3 decades a foregone conclusion? The real story that fascinates 20th century historians is not when World War II began. The real story concerns the tension between those who understood the long-term implications of what was happening and those who did not. In America today, I believe the same is just as true. Aboard the Titanic, many people did not know exactly when the iceberg was struck. Most passengers were oblivious to the collision until they were informed by crew members well after the steel plates of the hull buckled and ripped. And many of these same passengers scoffed at the notion that any collision could imperil the unsinkable ship. we too consider America to be vulturally invulnerable, and many of our changes are for the better. See how the crime rate has gone down in some cities recently? Even New York City is growing safer and more pleasant. Many feel that the economy is in good shape. We constantly reassure ourselves that America is fine and always will be. While debating the precise moment we hit the iceberg is less important than investigating what we Americans have been saying and doing since, if I had to pick the moment in our history that corresponds to the collision of the Titanic, I would select the early 1960s. This is the point when most of us should have realized we had encountered a serious problem. Each warning sign seems so minor in itself. When Jewish Rudi Gernreich, a self-proclaimed socialist from Vienna, settled in Los Angeles and foisted the topless bathing suit on a shocked America, it seemed titillating and daring. Many viewed this as harmless liberation and frivolous diversion. Others recognized the opening of a Pandora's box that would never again be shut, a challenge to the basic question of the role of sex in a civil society. A tug of war ensued. A few hailed the flagrantly homosexual Gernreich as the hero of the avant-garde. Hoisting him onto their shoulders, they used him as a banner beneath which to gather the forces that would liberate America from its prudish past. Those at the other end of the tug of war rope prophetically condemned the new fashion as a trend that would continue to expose ever more flesh to the public gaze. Another pivotal development of the 60s, which also failed to startle us out of our complacency, was the birth control pill. I need hardly spend time lauding it as a marvel of modern medical technology. That is unarguable. Even now, however, few have recognized its cultural impact. For the first time in our history, men were told that they were free to view sex as a leisure activity. Even responsibility for any unintended outcomes was transferred to the woman. This literally changed the nature of vast numbers of American men. Little by little, the changes became apparent. Men began to retain adolescence beyond all previously held records. A generation in which 26-year-old men had fought Hitler and come home to marry and start raising families was replaced by one populated by 40-year-old adolescents. How could this not affect our culture? We certainly had hit the iceberg, but only a few knew it, and even fewer cared. In the first-class ballroom, the dance continued. Chapter 3. A Strange Double Standard. Calling for a return to the enduring values that nurtured our nation through both its greatest and darkest days is not radical. If anything, it is an act of return. Not that long ago, when Americans said something was right or wrong, they meant right or wrong in the eyes of God, as revealed in the Bible. In advocating a return to those days, I am not suggesting anything new. I am recommending something old and proven. I am suggesting we turn around and retrace our steps until we once again find ourselves in familiar and safe territory. During the last few years, one group has begun to respond to the fact that America is on a dangerous downward slope. Regarded by some with admiration and by others with vilification, the so-called Christian right has not caused a rift through this land. They simply have recognized and called attention to the fact that one exists. In the time-honored American tradition, they have mobilized the political process in an attempt to return America to a safer course. If one examines several recent events through the eyes of religious Americans, it is hard to see the changes America has undergone as anything other than a deliberate attempt to alter our nation's foundations in a way that denies and denigrates religious faith. I believe it's important that we recognize the recent surge in political activism among Americans of faith to be what it truly is. It is their response to a perceived threat to their interests, a threat to the very foundations of religious faith and liberty on which America was founded. Let's face it. Participating in the democratic process through this kind of political activism earns admiration when practiced by Jesse Jackson on behalf of African-American causes. It is greeted enthusiastically when practiced by Jewish groups. It is warmly welcomed when practiced by homosexual activists. But when Christian groups organize to protect their interests, they are demonized. Not only is this intellectually dishonest, it is also inconsistent with the American way. Jews may be encouraged to vote out of office those representatives perceived to be inadequately supportive of Israel. Blacks may be encouraged to vote out of office those representatives who are thought to harbor illicit feelings. Same with pro-gay and lesbian interest groups. Why, then, the double standard? Why is it unacceptable for Christians to encourage one another to vote out of office those politicians who oppose their family-friendly agendas? Why is only Christian participation in the democratic process perceived as intolerance and a threat to constitutional safety? Unlike religious Catholics and Jews, religious Protestants tend to rely on the nation's public schools for their children's education. Reading, writing, arithmetic, history, science, and so on. But then aggressive secularism was forced onto the nation's schools during the 1960s, 70s, and 80s, and increased in intensity with each passing year. It reached unprecedented heights of extremism during the 90s. Not only did Christian parents find that academic standards had declined, but when they sent their six-year-olds off to first grade, anticipating excited accounts of traditional learning and activities, they discovered that they had been naive and deceived. For example, in the early 1990s, New York children came home from school speaking of an explicit lesbian advocacy text read in class, "Heather Has Two Mommies." Christian parents' religious beliefs instruct that the best home situation for a child is a loving mother and father, and that lesbianism, something they never would discuss with a six-year-old, is a sin. Yet their children's teacher taught that their way of thinking showed a lack of compassion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.